And today's session is all about that, where we'll try to talk about source encoding. Okay, so this will be the crux of this unit. As I told, the minimum number of binary digits. So we'll be talking about binary digits, as we'll also take R array digits, where we move away from the binary zeros and ones. So we can also take the cases where there is a quaternary kind of representation will be used for representing each of the sample. But before taking such cases, we'll be specifically talking about the representation of the sample with respect to bits only. The minimum number of bits required to encode a message, where you had shown in the last session, will be equal to the entropy itself if all the sources are equiprobable. Okay, so where each message will be occurring with say a specific probability, say p. Now we'll try to realize the case for non-equiprobable messages. Okay, our aim is to realize the case with non-equiprobable messages. Okay, all right. Okay, so the basic idea is to prove that average number of binary digits per message required for this case for encoding unequiprobable messages will be arbitrarily some entropy h of m, definitely, which will be less than the maximum entropy required with respect to the case of equiprobable messages. Okay, so for that, let us consider. Okay. Consider a source, okay, which emitting messages, say from M1, M2 up to say MN, okay, which are occurring with probability P1, P2 up to PN. Okay, so these are not equal. Okay, let's consider a case, okay, where we'll be taking about a sequence. Let's consider a sequence of N messages. Okay, N messages where this N is tending to infinity. So we'll take a sequence of messages emitted by the source. So let's say that sequence consists of N, a capital N messages, and let's assume that this N is infinite. So it's very collection of the very large amount of messages which are emitted by the source. And we know that if Ki represents the number of times message Mi occurs in this sequence. Okay. Let me tell you, we have considered a sequence of capital N messages where the source is emitting only the messages from M1 to M subscript small n. So the collection of this capital N messages, in that collection, the M1 may be appearing some, you know, say some 10 times, M2 may be appearing say say some 100 times, and so on. So each of these messages will be appearing more than once. And if that frequency of occurrence of those messages, say for Mi, if it's occurring say for Ki times, then we know with the basic understanding of probability, or using your law of large numbers itself, we know that we can define that the probability of occurrence of that message Mi is nothing but the number of times it has occurred in favor of the message Mi over the complete sample space, which is capital N. Of course, we have understood that this N is tending to infinity. Okay, so this is basically using law of large numbers. Okay, our basic understanding of the probability itself. So let's say this is the thing that we have with us. This implies that, okay, so this implies that the message MI, this implies that the message MI occurs how many times? MI is occurring for KI times. This is the frequency of occurrence of MI. So with this basic relation, MI is occurring, which is actually the equation of KI itself, KI times. So this is occurring, I mean, this is appearing for KI times, which is nothing but N times PI. Of course, with N tending to infinity. Okay, so each MI message is appearing for N times, you know, PI, where PI is the probability with which, you know, each of the messages is occurring. So if there is any other message, say for example, if I take some message, say as MN plus 1, which is not emitted by the source itself, we'll assume that for any messages other than this M1 to M1, MN, they'll occur with zero probability. Okay, so which is not belong to this set of messages. Okay, so please, you know, make sure that, you know, we'll be specifically talking about the source which is emitting the messages offset from M1 to MN only. Okay.
Sir.
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
Sir, if all the elements are occurring only once, then these events will become equiprobable, no, sir?
Yeah, if they are occurring one time, I mean, only for the case with occurring once, definitely they'll be equiprobable, but we are avoiding that kind of instance. That's the reason I am taking such amount of messages. Definitely, it will be at least N plus, you know, one messages will be there in my collection. Of course, it is not N plus one. This is, you know, an infinite amount of messages in my in my basket. I'm just picking each of those messages which will be occurring with a probability of KI by capital N.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yeah. Fine. So we are avoiding such case where it will, you know, it will have a closure with respect to the previous case where we had discussed yesterday that it will give me the maximum entropy. So we are considering today about the unequiprobable distribution of these messages which are occurring or emitting by the source. Okay, so if you take any capital N sequences, right? So as you know, the infinity, you know, the set of these infinite messages or the group of messages which are infinite in number. If I take another group of such infinite amount of messages, definitely these two sequences, even if they are different, but then the messages appearing in those sequences will be again M1 to MN only. Okay, so what I'm trying to say here is, if say for a sequence, for any sequence, okay, for any sequence, for any other sequence to be more specific, for any other sequence, okay, say I will take, I'll say it as, you know, say something like, you know, this has N1 and this has N2, where this also has infinite amount of messages, but the messages which will be which will be occurring in this infinite sequence will be again from M1 to MN only the order of appearing, order of these messages would be different. Okay, please keep that in mind. Okay, so only say first M2 will occur, then probably, you know, M10 may occur, and so on. Okay, if I take any sequence which is an infinite collection of all these messages, the messages exist in that sequence will be again from M1 to MN only, but the difference would be in their order. Okay, so with that notion, let's consider a typical sequence Okay, so let's consider a typical sequence. Okay, say SN, S capital N. Okay, this of capital N messages from the source, again with probabilities of occurring is from P1 to PN. We know that the messages will occur with a frequency of n times p1, n times p2, and so on. So with that, I say where this will have messages from m1 to mn. So the frequency of occurrence of these messages, of each message, is n times p1, n times p2, and similarly up to n times pn. So this is the frequency of occurring of these individual messages. So with that, I can write that the probability of this sequence itself, okay, so probability of this typical sequence in this order, where m1 comes first, m2 comes later, and finally we'll be getting mn. Say for this typical sequence, the probability of occurring this sequence, I can write this as we know that this is product of individual probabilities. Okay, so the probability of this, m1 is p1, but this is occurring how many times? np1 times. Similarly, the probability of the message to m2 is p2. This is occurring np2 times, and so on up to pn per npn. Okay, this is for this particular sequence. For any other sequence, we'll also get the similar products, but the order would be different. But of course, since it's a product, the order doesn't matter. Okay, so the whole idea is that if I take any sequence, all sequences of infinite groupings of all these messages, even they are equiprobable to occur. Where I say this order, m1, m2, and up to mn, the occurrence of this sequence in this order is equiprobable with any other sequence ordering in different, occurring in different orders. Okay, so with that notion, we'll take things little forward, where we need to find out. Yes.
Sir, those np1, np2 are the frequencies of the message signals m1 and m2, no, sir?
Correct.
So then the P1 into NP1, no sir, like you have to multiply the frequency with the respective probability, no sir?
Right. So to answer your question, say M1, say if it is appearing, say something like 100 times, right? So you'll have to multiply this P1 into P2 into P3 for 100 times. Correct.
So it's basically like expectation for random variable.
Exactly. This is occurring so many times. This is NP1 itself says that this is occurring. Say if message M1 is occurring 100 times, NP1 will represent 100, the value 100. So P1 raised to 100 it will be.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Yeah. All right. So with that understanding, as also I told that all possible n sequences or n messages for that matter. So for all possible sequences of these n messages from the source will have the similar composition, only the order would be different. And each of these sequence is equiprobable to occur. Okay, with that idea, I'll make a note of that, saying that since all possible sequences of n messages, of course this is n is tending to infinity, say all possible sequences of these capital N messages from this source that we are considering will have same composition. Okay, same composition. Okay, where the composition refers to that they'll have the messages from M1 to MN only. Okay. Okay, and are equiprobable. Okay, so this with this idea back at our, you know, at our mind, we will we can write the for these long sequences of this infinitely, you know, long sequences of these messages, we need to encode one such sequence. Okay, we'll pick this specific case of S suffix capital N. So say we need to encode one such sequence. So let's say we need L suffix capital N bits. Okay, so as I told, we'll be considering the binary digits to represent. Let's say to encode all such, you know, one such sequence containing all the messages emitted by the source. Okay, so it could be the source emitting M100 times, or, you know, M2 with some 200 times. So to specific with respect to one such typical sequence, let's say we need L suffix N amount of bits to represent as a whole. So which is nothing but is the amount of information conveyed by the sequence. Okay, I hope you all agree with me. Okay, this is nothing but the total number of bits required to represent the complete sequence. So in other words, this is the total amount of information that is getting conveyed by the sequence that we have considered to be of this order. That we know already, that if L suffix N is the amount of information, we know that this is equivalent to the information log, which is actually inversely proportional to the probability of occurring of the sequence itself. Correct. With the basic definition of information, we know that this I is nothing but log of inverse of pi specific to any message mi. So with that notion, with definition of information, we can say that ln is a, you know, length of the complete amount of bits that is required to encode the sequence is inversely proportional to logarithmic of probability of occurrence of that sequence itself. So if I say this as equation one and say this as two, I can substitute one in two. Okay, substitute 1 in 2, what do we get? I get ln, which is equal to logarithmic of, the denominator is product of all those probabilities, right? So this is p1 raised to n times p1. Up to pn, n, pn. All right. So this can be simplified further as simply log of, this is product of all these parts, which I take the logarithmic inside, which will be actually, if I can write, by taking this logarithmic inside, so this will be log of 1 over p1 raised to np1 plus, since the multiplication will be converted to the sums of all these the products under logarithmic, plus finally it will go up to pn raised to npn. So succinctly, I can write this as you know, n is a common term, which can be taken out from the summation as 1 to n pi times log of 1 over pi. And we know that by definition of entropy, this summation that we know from the definition of entropy is nothing but H of M. And hence, this Ln, what we have started with, is n times of entropy. Okay, so this will have units of bits, binary digits. Okay, note that, I repeat, this Ln is a length of the code word. Okay, so this is actually is the length of code word, okay, of required to encode n messages in a sequence. Sorry. Okay. So this is the length. The code word refers to the number of bits in the to represent. So this is nothing but the code word is nothing but number of bits involved. Okay. So with that, we can find out average number of digits or bits. In general, you can say digits, number of digits required per message. Okay, so this is Ln gives me the total length of the code word, or the total length of the number of bits which is involved to encode all the messages involved in a sequence. If I want to find out what is the average number of digits or bits required per message, which we know that the average, if this is a total length and there are n messages in the sequence, so if I take this n to the other side, so this is the average number of digits required per message. I simply put it as L, which is nothing but the entropy itself. Okay, so this I can say this is as number of digits as I had mentioned. I'll keep this as digits itself. Okay, so mathematically we have written, this is nothing but number of on an average we need H of M, which is nothing but the entropy itself, which is required to encode a sequence of source messages involved in a sequence. All right. Okay. All right. So in other words, you know, I can write this as, this implies on the average, minimum, as we have seen the definition of entropy as also as this is number of minimum number of digits that are required to represent any messages is entropy itself, and hence we have got the entropy as the average number of digits required to represent each message. So combining those two different sentences, we can put it in one single sentence statement as, on the average, the minimum number of digits required to encode this message source is entropy itself. Okay. Also, this statement is without proof. Okay. So this statement is without proof. You can, you know, refer. I'll put it in, you know, on my miscellaneous resources. But this is very much necessary to put this. Okay, it is impossible to find any uniquely decodable code. Okay, any uniquely decodable code whose average length is less than h of m, which is entropy. Okay, so there should be minimum the entropy, in other words, represents minimum number of digits required on an average. Conversely, that it is impossible if the number of messages per number of bits per message falls below the entropy or h of m, then it is impossible to decode at the receiver end. Okay, so this is just a corollary or the converse statement of the first one. Okay, but this can be proved with the basic probability understanding, but our job is not to do that, but just to take the meaning of this entropy and try to apply onto our digital communication. All right, so with that, we'll get into an important aspect of today's discussion, which is known as Huffman coding. We'll take specific case. How will you try to encode the source if you are given with the probability of occurrence of individual messages? Of course, we expect unequal probability distribution of these messages, and how will you try to encode that? For a more rigorous involvement of this discussion, we'll go with a proof first, then we'll try to apply, but we'll not get into the proof or the background of this Huffman coding. So without the proof, we'll try to apply directly, but I'll try to give a basic understanding what we are trying to do here. The source, this is actually gives us a source encoding theorem. That's what we had started with, as source encoding. So Huffman coding, in other words, this indirectly gives a source encoding theorem, which says that to encode a source with entropy h of m that we had defined earlier, we need on an average a minimum of h of m binary digits per message. That's the statement that we had done earlier. So that is nothing but your source encoding theorem. Okay, to put it to specific respect to statement, to encode a source, with entropy h of m, we need on the average, similar to the previous statement, but let me put it more formally. We need on the average of h of m bits per message. So that is a statement of source encoding theorem. So the number of digits in the code word, as I told, is the length of the code word. So the code word refers to the group of binary digits or bits representing each message. So the complete length of the code word, the number of digits in the code word is called as length of the code word itself. So saying that, we'll be using this terminology throughout this unit and next unit. So length of the code word is nothing but the number of digits in the code word. So thus the average word length of an optimum code is h of m itself. So this is the optimum code. So our aim is to represent each message on an average of h of m bits per message. So this is the optimum code. So optimum mode code will actually will have a h of m number of bits representing each message. But to do that, say that to optimum code, please understand this part. The optimum code that is required to encode any information source which is emanating infinite number of messages. So the optimum code to represent such a source is actually will have average word length or code word length as statement based on the fact that we had considered infinite number of messages in a sequence. So where n was tending to infinity. But practically to encode messages, we'll have to wait for infinite amount of time to collect all such sequences and try to build such an encoding format which will have an optimum code. So practically, you know, it's not feasible at all, which simply consumes time, and of course it involves huge amount of memory, correct? So this is practically not feasible. So of course this is our aim to achieve, but this is definitely not possible because of time and memory constraint. Okay, so the how do you overcome such a problem? That is defined by the famous scientist Hoffman. So we'll try to implement his algorithm directly on specific cases and try to say that the code that gets generated using this Hoffman algorithm definitely will not be optimum, but it will give you such a format or such length of code word where it will be greater than the limit that we have set as h of m, but the cost of that would not be too high. Okay, so instead, it is preferable. Okay, it's preferably we'll encode message directly. Messages directly. Okay. The price or the cost involved or the price that we have to pay, the price has to be paid in terms of obviously of increased word length. Okay, so we'd be requiring a little more amount of bits to represent the complete sequence. Okay, so let's try to implement this. This statements are without proof, or the algorithm that we are going to implement goes without proof in this course, but definitely we'll try to analyze based on the result that we obtain. So let me quickly take one example before I conclude my session today, so that this will etch in your memory when you come back to the next session, as we'll take a few more examples to prove that. Okay, let me quickly go with the first example. Okay, so this is little interesting. Okay, so we take a sequence of messages. I'll try to tabulate that. Okay, so let's say this is the original source, which is emitting messages. Say this title will go as messages. This with individual probability of occurrence of these messages, say both are known to us. Okay, if these are known to us, let us say there are 6 messages, m1, m2, m3, m4, m5 and m6. Let us say each of these message will have certain probability of occurrence. Let me take say this as 0.3, say this as 0.25, so this is 0.55, Let us say this as 0.15, this is 0.7 in total. Let us say this as 0.12, and let us say this is with 0.10, and how much is left? 0.55, 0.7, 0.92. Yeah, we'll be left with, we are left with just 0.08. Probably, you know, you won't be given with a, such a neat table in your test or in your quizzes, but randomly, if the probabilities of these individual messages are given to you, your first job is to arrange these messages in an increasing order of the probabilities. Okay, so in my case, I have specifically taken increasing order of probabilities from 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. In your case, the order would be different if these messages are occurring with different probabilities. Say, probably M3 may be having would be having a lesser probability than M5, and you may have to swap those messages in your table. Okay, so please make sure that you arrange these messages. Okay, somewhere I have to write this. Okay. Arrange the messages in increasing, decreasing order of probability. Okay, so with that, we are ready to apply Huffman coding. Now, if you do it for one case, I think it's pretty easy to apply for any question that is given to you. Okay, so this is, if this is original source, we will have a reduced source. Okay, you'll understand why it is called as reduced source. Okay, the first algorithm in this step, I'll write the algorithm later, but I'll try to implement directly, so that next class, when you come back, I'll list down the important points that we have done in an algorithmic way. Okay, so what we'll be trying to do from the first step in this algorithm is that combine last two messages, say M5 and M6, with their probabilities. Okay, so the probabilities of other messages will be as it is. Say this has 0.3, this will go as 0.3, this as 0.25, 0.15, and this is 0.12. okay, and combining the probabilities of last two, this will give me the reduced set of sources with the probability of how much? 0.18. And of course, I should keep on arranging the probabilities with their decreasing order of probability. So I see that the combining these two probabilities is greater than the probability of message M4. So that I have to rewrite this list of probabilities as, this will sit here as 0.18. Addition of these two probabilities as 0.18, and I have to now write, sorry, this will go still further up, sorry, I did not look into 0.15 here, pardon. So this will have to rearrange, and this will sit at this point as point. You'll understand what I'm trying to do. So this is 0.18. Next, in a decreasing order, this is 0.15, and then 0.12. Okay, so this has been reduced. We'll call this set as, say, S1. Okay, so this is a reduced set. Then again, the process continues. We'll have to combine the last two probabilities, and the addition of 0.15 plus and 0.12 would be 0.27. So 0.27 in this order will be sitting in the second position. Okay, so this will go and sit here. Okay, so this is actually 0.27. Rest of the probabilities have to be retained as it is. 0.30, 0.25, then there is 0.18. Okay, next it is continued in this fashion. Again, we have to add these two probabilities, which is 0.43, and this will definitely will sit in the top. Okay, so this is 0.43, and rest of the probabilities have to be retained as it is, 0.30. Okay, and of course we have 0.27 in the list. And as a final step, I need to add last two probabilities, which is 0.57, which will sit at the top. Okay, so this is 0.57, and we are left with, this is 0.57, which is sitting at the top, and we are left with the probability 0.43. So we have started initially by combining the two messages which were having least probabilities, and finally we have left with the final, you know, two probabilities. Of course, the sum of these two probabilities would be definitely one, but we need to stop at the stage where we'll be left with just two messages, and each of the stage can be said as, say, S2, S3, and S4. So we have stopped at a stage where we are left with just two messages. Now our job is to assign bits for each of these messages. This is an important step, to encode the messages from M1 to M6, which are given in the question itself. To assign bits, this should be carefully done. To assign bit, let me pick some other color. Okay. To assign bits, we'll have to start from the last stage, which is S4. Since we have got two bits to represent, 1 and 0, I can give 1 to this and 0 to this. But usually, we'll go with assigning 0 for the higher probability and 1 for the lesser probability. Definitely you can do with the other way around as well. It doesn't reduce with respect to the number of bits on an average to represent each of these messages, but this is a usual way of doing it. But whatever you assign, you place follow a similar step that I'll be explaining you right away. So from this point we'll have to trace back. Okay, so tracing back to these two probabilities, the 0.57 probabilities is combination of 0.3 and 0.7. So these two messages both will have assignment of bits as 0 and 0. Of course, this 0.43 will have 1. But since again this is a combination of 2, again we can assign 0 and 1 to the next bit position. So I'll be giving 0 and 1. For the next bit position. So this will have 0, 0 and 0, 1 as its representation. Similarly, if I trace back from this, okay, so if I trace back from 0.43, so this has to be given with 1 and 1, and of course there are two it's addition of two probabilities, and I'll be assigning 0 and 1 in the second position for these two, and of course this has to be retained as it is, 0, 0 and 0, 1. And tracing back from this point, 0.27 is combination of 0.15 and 0.12. 0.27 we have already given as 0, 1. So I'll retain this as 0, 1. The higher probability will have the next position as 0, and the next probability will have 1, it's in next position. The others will have to be retained as it is. 0.18 we represented with 1, 1, so this will go with 1, 1. 0.25 we represented with 1, 0, and 0.30 will go with the same representation as 0, 0. Okay, so again, tracing back with the initial stage that we had begun with, 0.18 was combination of 0.1 and 0.08, which is a representation as 0.18 as 1, 1 each. And since there are two messages, I'll go with adding 0 and 1, it's least position. Rest of the assignments will be retained as it is. 0.15 we represented with 0, 1, 0. 0.25 we represented as 1, 0, and 0.30 we have represented as 0, 0. Okay, so this is a final assignment of bits, or this is a final encoding of the source, which is emitting the messages M1 to M6. So what we have done. So analysis is an important one. Okay, so that I'll conclude today's session with that last note. If we can find out the average length of this code that we have obtained. Okay, the code. That we have obtained is in fact called as a compact code. Okay, so whose average length. So average length of this compact code can be calculated as L. As we know, average is a weighted average, where L is summing from 1 to N, Pi times Li, where Pi is a probability with which message Mi is occurring. Li is the length of the message Mi. Okay, and of course divided by P1 plus P2 up to P6. And of course we know that P1 to P6 summation will be, the probabilities will sum up to unity. So, and hence the average length of this compact code can be found out as is 0.3. Okay, so P1 is 0.3. And what is the length of the message M1 now? What is the code word length? There are two bits which are assigned to message M1 now. So the length of this code word for message M1 is 2. Similarly, for the message M2, this is 0.25 times 2. Okay, the length of the code word for a message M2 is 1, 0. This is 2, which is a representation of 1, 0. And for all the messages from M3 to M6, it is 3 each, right? So I can say that this is 0.15 for M3. I'll write that exclusively, plus 0.12 times 3 plus 0.10 times 3. And finally, give me the last 5 minutes so that we'll wind up today. 0.08 times 3. And if you try to calculate this, how much you'll be getting? This is 0.6, this is 0.5, 1.1, this is 0.45, 0.65, 0.26. Yeah, if you try to calculate this, this will be getting as around 2.45 binary digits or bits. Okay, but as you know, as our reference, the entropy H of M, or simply H, okay, is nothing but summation by its definition 1 to n pi log 1 over pi, okay, by its definition is this. If you try to apply this formula, say p1 log 1 over p1 plus p2 log of 1 over p2 and so on, this will give us as around 2.418 binary digits. Okay, as you can see, we were supposed to get around 2.418 binary digits on an average to have an optimum code, but the price that we have paid by assigning the bits for individual messages is around 2.45, you know, binary digits. So this is the length of, on average length of the messages if we are taken infinite messages in a sequence. But this is not practically true. So we have gone with a most practical way of assigning bits to individual messages, and the price that we have paid is not, you know, much. So continuing from this point, we need to draw certain, you know, conclusions and important observations. So based on this example itself, I'll try to draw few important observations. The process is, you know, clear to everyone. All right. So the first and important, you know, observation is that the merit, okay, the merit or the performance parameter of any code, the merit of any code, okay, what is the average length of the encoded representation? Okay, by its average length in comparison with entropy. Okay, entropy sets the lower bound, or it sets the standard that this should be the minimum amount of bits required to represent on an average the messages. Right, so this is actually, when we try to compare this with respect to the entropy, the practically whatever average length that we have obtained, that term is known as code. Yes, it's already in recording mode. Okay. All right, so with respect to redundancy, it is just, you know, one minus of this efficiency, and we'll talk, you know, more about this redundancy, which has, you know, primary you know, influence on our encoding theorem. All right, so with that, we'll draw second observation. Whatever that we have done in our previous example, we observe that whatever Huffman code that we obtained is actually an example for variable length code, where there were unequal code word lengths for each of those messages. Right, so you may think that this may lead to the a problem or an error at the decoding side, where we are always in the mindset that whenever we have, say, for example, in this, in our case, six messages are given to us. So far, in our, based on our digital circuit techniques, we always thought that we need a minimum of 3 bits to represent each of these messages. But with this algorithm, we have arrived at variable length code where few of the messages are not of of code word length 3. Okay, it could be, you know, similar state with the messages of, you know, if we have more samples of the messages, some messages may be represented with single bit. Few of the messages would be 2 bits or 3, and so on. Right, so it appears that probably it could be erroneous decoding technique that would be, decoder would utilize such a technique where it may result in erroneous decoding. Right, so we'll take an example that's to prove that even though the Huffman code is variable length code, the decoder still can correctly decode what actually the messages have, you know, sent from the transmitter end. Okay, say for example, consider a case. Okay, so let me put it at a sentence saying that in spite of, you know, variable length, a decoder can correctly decode the messages. Okay, so let's consider a case. Okay, transmitter has transmitted say a message of format, say I'll take a case, say M3, M2, M5, say M1, M6, and M4. I'll just take 6 messages. It could be more than this. Let's take a simple, you know, one of the cases where this is the combination of the messages that is transmitted by the transmitter. Okay, so in encoding format using Huffman, you know, coding, you know, algorithm, we need to represent this in terms of bits, where we have obtained M3 as 010, right? So we'll have to represent in binary form. So this is 010, M2 is 10, okay, M2 being 10, M5 being 110, M1 being 00, M6 and M4. M6 is 111 and M4 is 011. All right. So this is the binary representation of what transmitter has sent. Okay. So you can verify that. We can definitely verify that this message sequence can be decoded in only one way. How is that possible? Let me take the case of decoding at the receiver end. Okay, you may say that receiver is unaware of the lengths of these individual messages. It is unaware of the code word lengths of individual messages. In spite of that, receiver still can't decode it correctly. Say, let's say it has a lookup table in the sense it tries to decode this. It doesn't have any demarcation. The receiver doesn't have any demarcation saying that. So M2 is sent after, you know, a gap of say milliseconds after M3. Never, you know, that will happen. So all these messages are separated in very strict sense. The bit durations of individual bits are, you know, constant. There is no delay at all. So in spite of absence of demarcation between the messages, let's say the receiver tries to decode it. Receiver has lookup table at its end. It checks the first bit. Let's say this has been the first bit that is arrived at the receiver end. Say bit 0, it checks the lookup table. It checks at the lookup table. There is no message which has been coded as 0, right? So it comes back and, you know, continues for the next bit duration. Say next is 1. So it checks in the lookup table. Is there any code in the table representing 01? There is no code which is represented as 01. I mean, there is no message which has been encoded as 01 in the lookup table. So it continues for another bit duration, which will give me the combination of 010. All right. So this 010, which is a 3-bit duration, when it's checked with the lookup table, it understands that, you know, 010 represents message, you know, M3. Right. So it correctly tries to decode that this is M3. It tries to demark by itself by verifying with the lookup table that it has got. All right. Similarly, the process can, you know, continue. Say next is bit is 1. Definitely there is no message which is represented with single bit as 1. So next is 10. 10 is M2, and definitely 10 is M2, and, you know, so on. So M5 is 110. M1 is, I believe it is 00. Correct. So and so on, right? So M6 is 111 and M4 is is 011. So accordingly, it tries to give that demarcation, or tries to address the problem of absence of demarcation which has been sent by the transmitter. Okay, so in spite of Huffman code being variable length code, there will not be any errors incurred in the decoding part or the receiver end. All right, so that should be understand clearly. Okay, so this actually, yes.
Sir, for for this to actually work, that means like both the transmitter and the receiver have to work on the same principle, they are both have different coding.
Principle is one part. The second important aspect is synchronization. Both the transmitter and receiver should be in sync with each other. In other words, both should be operating in a similar clock frequency. Okay, so that's being looking at the larger part of the requirement or the design aspect of both transmitter and receiver. Okay, so this uniqueness, whatever I explained briefly, this is assured by. This is assured by that property is known as a special property. Okay, I didn't mention that, but still, this is the right time to say that this is a special property is known as prefix. Okay, prefix. One second. That is make it more clear. Property that there is no code word is a prefix of another code word. Okay, so there is an important property of Huffman code. What I mean by this is, if I go back to the encoding table, you can see 00 is not the sequence which will appear in any of the encoding format. 10 similarly doesn't appear in the initial parts of any of the decoding encoding format that we have utilized in this algorithm, right? So the no encoding bits here is not a part of prefix of any other code word. So with that special property of this Huffman coding theorem, it enables right decoding at the decoder end in spite of absence of any demarcation. Okay, so a similar procedure that we have done for binary digits or bits, where we try to combine our two messages and arrived at final stage as two messages and try to assign bits to each of those and traced it back. Similar can be extended to any compact array code. So in general, I'll give you the algorithm as I was explaining the last session. So although I have not written any algorithm for Huffman code, I'll try to write in more generic form. So in general, for any compact R array code, so this is not binary now, so this is for any R array code, we can write the Huffman algorithm. All right, so Huffman algorithm is very simple. Whatever I have told in sentences yesterday, I'll just write in whatever orally I have explained yesterday, I'll just try to make it more formal. Okay, so first, arrange the messages in descending order of probability. Okay, that's the first step that you are supposed to do. Otherwise, it will not be the right form of encoding. Okay, so then combine the last R messages. In this case, in general, it is R. So for binary case, we just combined last two messages. So combine last R messages into one message. Okay, so that's the next step that you are going to do as stage one. Okay, then rearrange again. Okay, the new set, we call it as reduced set, right? Reduced. Okay, reduced set in the order of, again, in the order of descending probability. All right, so that would be the successive stages, the procedure that you are going to apply. So we need to repeat this, right? So this will go in the loop. So repeat the procedure, repeat the steps, say from A to C, right? Say from A to C until the final set reduces to, until the final set reduces to how many? Just R messages. Okay, in our binary case, we ended up with just two messages at the end. All right, so next is an important step to assign digits to each of these messages. Each of these messages, okay, each of these messages is assigned, okay, assigned one of, okay, in case of R array, you know, digits, one of the R numbers. Okay, so this R numbers is basically, in case of binary, there was just, you know, 0 and 1. So in general, it can go up to R minus 1. Okay, so although I will not write exclusively to assign, you know, whether to assign higher probability to R minus 1 or with 0 for the higher probability, that goes with the intuition. Anything is fine. The average length of the code words, whatever you get, will also be, you know, the same, but only the encoding format will change. Nothing will affect the average code length or, you know, the in terms of the performance of the encoding will not change at all. Okay, so that goes with completely the intuition. All right. So then once we assign for the last, you know, the R numbers for the last stage, we should trace it back. So regress exactly the same way. Same way as in the binary case. Okay. As in the binary case, until each of the original message has been assigned a code, until all the messages, sorry, until all the messages are consumed. Okay, so this could be the algorithm that you can, you know, keep it, you know, handy. All right, so that is the third, you know, important observation that what we did in Huffman coding. The fourth and important point, which, you know, we'll take an application, you know, example as well, that what would be the case if it is, you know, slightly different than what the example that we have considered. So that can happen with the, you know, observation that for any R array code, okay, we will have, okay, we will have exactly R messages, we'll exactly have R messages left in the final reduced set. Okay, in case of binary, we had ended up with just two messages at the final stage. Okay, this can happen only if and only if the total number of original message the total number of original messages is equal to, okay, is equal to K, so R we have considered here. So this is R plus K times N minus 1. So that this N is coming from. So this is R plus K times R minus 1, where K is an integer. I'll just explain that. Where K is any integer. Okay. So as we know that as we move from one stage to another stage, we are going to combine R amount of messages in each stage, and we'll be reducing that into the reduced set. All right. So each stage, as you progress from stage 1 to stage 2, the number of messages in each set gets reduced by the amount R minus 1. Okay. So hence, there is a total of K amount of reductions that is happening across the K stages. And hence, its number of stages is K, and each step is, you know, reduced with, you know, we'll have, you know, R minus 1 amount of messages in each reduced set. And hence, R is the original reduced set. So if the total number of original messages that we have begun with is of the form of R plus K times R minus 1, then definitely, you know, we can, will not have any problem. In case of the number of original messages is not equal to this, then we'll have to add some dummy messages. We'll take an example to explain this. Don't worry. Okay. So if the above condition is not satisfied, then add dummy messages with, of course, just not adding the messages will do the, you know, the job, with zero probability. Correct. Finally, we are going to add the probability, and this dummy messages should not disturb the original probability distribution. All right. So